Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents New to You, How to Buy, Fix, and Keep Secondhand Clothing by Melody Fortier, narrated by Kelsey Navarro Foster. Publisher's note: this audiobook includes bonus material. Please visit tantor.com and type New to You into the search box. Follow the link to the book's page. Then, under the supplemental content section, please enter the access code STYLE and then click the unlock button to access the bonus material. The code should be entered in all lowercase letters. All charts, illustrations, and other visual elements referenced in this audiobook can be found in the bonus material. Introduction. Over the decades, the vintage scene has morphed from fashion experiment to established niche. Whether you're new to vintage or looking for ways to expand an existing vintage wardrobe, there are so many reasons to look to the past for your new favorite garment. Style. Vintage offers countless style choices. It is a treasure trove for honing a signature look. You will find an endless bounty of fashion prints and colors, along with stunning materials, fabulous details, and accessories galore. Each decade of fashion trended toward particular silhouettes, so it's easy to find a cut that complements your body type. Quality and value. The quality of most vintage wear is finer than today's off-the-rack garments. Manufacturers of contemporary low to mid-range clothing have been producing what's called fast fashion for a number of years now, churning out multiple collections each year. These garments are, for all intents and purposes, disposable. On average, they start to fall apart after 6 or 7 wearings. Today's lower-end garments might be cheap in price, but you get what you pay for. With vintage, you can find quality, well-made clothing and accessories for reasonable prices. Sustainability. The environmental impact of fast fashion is devastating. Textile manufacturing is often located in water-stressed areas of the world. Combined, the world's textile factories consume a whopping 80 billion liters of water each year, accounting for 1/10 of all industrial water consumption. They also produce extremely toxic wastewater that all too often finds its way into natural waterways. 2/3 of garment textiles are synthetic. Synthetic fibers such as polyester are made from petroleum and shed microplastics that contaminate and destroy marine ecosystems. These fibers end up in the food chain and ultimately our own bodies. Studies are finding that microplastics cause a myriad of health issues. It gets worse. Fashion production accounts for 10% of total global carbon emissions, and millions of tons of discarded clothing end up in landfills each year. Plus, the textile industry is notorious for labor exploitation. Vintage clothing, on the other hand, is all about recycling and sustainability. As long as you know what to watch out for and how to do basic restoration, your secondhand clothes will last much longer than modern fast fashion without the destructive effects. Supporting small enterprise. The vast majority of vintage businesses are microbusinesses, and microbusinesses are important. They provide niche products and services that larger businesses deem too unprofitable. They fill up empty storefronts, which help local economies. They often care about and contribute to their communities in a way larger stores do not, and they are a brighter alternative for those with limited employment choices. So how does one go about finding, choosing, and buying vintage? That's where this book comes in. New to You has all the information you need to become a savvy vintage shopper. You will learn about the different vintage venues, brick-and-mortar stores, online shopping, vintage trade shows, and how to spot a reputable vintage business. This book will also arm you with surefire guidelines to determine if you are getting reasonable value for your money. There are no pricing standards for vintage, and secondhand clothes may have flaws and issues, so without guidance, it's hard to know what to pay. You'll learn how to fix some of those flaws, and how to tell when they're fatal and unfixable, as well as how to care for and clean vintage clothing. Information that might come in handy for modern clothing, too. Vintage sizes are not the same as today's sizes, and this book will teach you how to determine fit and how to tell when a piece will need to be altered. And, of course, you'll learn a lot about fashion trends throughout the decades. I started wearing and buying vintage in the 1970s. It has been a lifelong passion for me. Coming from a family of seamstresses, I understood good fabric and construction, which gave me a jumpstart on navigating the vintage market. Still, I made my fair share of unfortunate purchases. Trial and error were my teachers. I want this book to be yours. Happy hunting to you. Chapter 1. Vintage defined. Vintage is a lot of things. It's classic and stylish. It can be fun and campy. It's even practical and green. Is it old? Yes, to a certain degree. Is it previously worn? Very often, it is. What, then, differentiates vintage from just plain old clothes? Why do celebrities and models proudly grace the red carpet in vintage gowns? Why do major fashion magazines regularly feature vintage wear? Trendsetters and fashionistas consider vintage to be an essential element in their wardrobes. So what, then, is vintage really? Enduring style. Any subject associated with fashion is fraught with intense opinions, and vintage is no different. Definitions vary widely, and some can be quite extreme or rigid. I once read an interview in which a high-end collector insisted that true vintage must bear an important designer label. I think it's safe to say that very few people would concur. I challenge anyone who claims that an authentic 1950s circle skirt or 1920s flapper dress is not really vintage, simply for lack of a designer label. On the opposite end of the spectrum is the broadly accepted idea that vintage is simply fashions from the past, anything that's at least 20 years old. As a professional vintage dealer, I'm uncomfortable with such a vague and arbitrary classification. Vintage is not just about age. It has evolved to become a fashion term. It's about essence and style. There's a lot of clothing on the secondary market that is more than two decades old, but that I do not include in my personal definition of vintage fashion. As a dealer, I pass over volumes of such nondescript clothing. I think we can all agree that not every piece of 20-year-old double-knit polyester deserves to be resurrected. It may meet the age requirement, but that's about all. Conversely, there are a few styles that are not very old, but that I do consider to be vintage fashion. Especially popular designs often creep back just at the 20-year mark or even before. See, for instance, the 2010s revival of 1990s grunge. So the true definition of vintage has something to do with age and quality or appeal, but that's not everything. For me, a key concept is what I like to call enduring style. That can mean several things. It can mean classic, like the boxy tweed suit made popular by Chanel, or it can be something innovative, like the sensuous bias cuts that Madeleine Vionnet created in the 1930s. Be they old or not so old, vintage fashions are about styles that are pioneering, classic, or iconic, as well as reflective of their era. And although their day may have come and gone, there is renewed interest in wearing them. That, for me, qualifies them as vintage. Antique and retro. Occasionally, I hear people confuse the terms vintage and antique. These are really two separate categories, and it's useful to know the difference, especially as you venture into the marketplace. Antique clothing and textiles are generally those that date prior to the 1920s. Some say that 100 years old is the rule. Others think as few as 80 years to qualify something as antique. Whichever number you choose, antique clothing is not usually purchased to be worn. As textiles age, they become more fragile and begin to disintegrate. In order to preserve them, they must be stored and handled properly. The beautiful silks and beaded dresses from the 1920s are seldom strong enough to withstand the stress of wear. Although some Victorian and Edwardian garments are still fairly sturdy and will hold up under gentle use, Antique textiles are most often sought as collector's items or for design reference. Another term for this older category of vintage is antique vintage. Most of today's dealers who sell vintage offer some antique clothing as well, and there are a few dealers who specialize in antique textiles exclusively. Retro is another term used, and often confused with vintage. Retro commonly refers to clothing designed to emulate past fashions. In the 1970s, for example, Gunny Sachs created retro Victorian-inspired dresses that became hugely popular. Retro vintage is vintage clothing that evokes an even earlier time than its own. Today, new retro clothing and shoes might emulate anything from 1940s-style pinup dresses to 1990s grunge. Contemporary designers are heavily influenced by vintage styles, and they are always creating retro-inspired collections. Every era is emulated, from Victorian to mod. A great deal of clothing described as retro today is actually newly produced, but vintage in style. Because it can be intimidating to buy real vintage, hence this book, people who are interested in the aesthetics alone may turn to these reproduction items instead, because they are easier to source, even though they lack the other benefits of vintage like sustainability and durability. They are generally of modern mass-produced quality. But the same has been true in every era. Some new clothing produced at that time has harkened back to the past. For the purposes of this book, retro will be used to mean vintage clothing or accessories that have been styled after fashions from an even earlier era. NWT, NOS, and other initialisms. While shopping for vintage, you're likely to come across a few other terms and funny abbreviations you're unfamiliar with. For example, dealers and online sellers may describe an item as NWT, new with tags, NBW, never been worn, and MIB, mint in box. With vintage, these words mean that the items were previously owned but never used. Similar terms such as dead stock or new old stock, NOS, refer to recently discovered and resurrected old store inventory that was not sold in its day. Never worn and dead stock clothing may not be thought of as secondhand, since it's never seen wear, but it's important not to assume that the condition will be just like brand new. Time and the elements always take a toll on textiles. Fading, water damage, creasing, and dust marks are just a few of the conditions that will affect even the best stored pieces. Even if a tag or description indicates that something was never used, make sure you examine it well. When shopping online, read descriptions carefully and ask questions if anything is unclear. You don't want any surprises. Supply and demand. The business of buying and selling vintage as street fashion began only around the late 1960s. Before that, textiles and clothing from earlier times were sought only by a handful of people, mostly theater and film costumers, fashion collectors, designers, museum curators, and occasionally the odd eccentric or artistic souls looking to mix vintage into their wardrobe. The average person might rummage through a relative's attic or hit the flea market searching for a costume, but generally it was all considered just old clothes. Though you might wear them out of thrift, they weren't usually fashion choices. At the end of the 60s, though, there was a rebellion against established fashion, and people looked for alternative modes of dress. They began experimenting with used clothing found in thrift stores and flea markets. It wasn't long before little shops selling pretty or interesting pre-worn apparel started springing up in cities like San Francisco and New York. In the beginning, it wasn't even called vintage. I don't recall hearing that term myself until the 1980s, but vintage, it was. The market for vintage fashion has ebbed and flowed over the past 5 decades, and recently demand has skyrocketed. Vintage permeates popular culture, both in reality and in influence. These days, there are outlets for buying vintage everywhere you turn. Brick and mortar stores in cities and towns, online shops, online auction sites, and even major trade events such as the Manhattan Vintage Show. Before the advent of such high demand, Thrift stores and flea markets were a cheap and plentiful source for vintage. Sadly, those days are gone, though you can still find a treasure here and there. And for some of us, the fun is in the hunt. The highs and the lows. Vintage covers nearly a century of fashion. Imagine almost 100 years worth of clothing and accessories from every background. Mail order catalogs, home sewn, department stores, boutiques, haute couture. With such an array, you're bound to wonder about quality. You'll surely run into some excellent pieces and some, well, not so stunning examples too. So how do you know what you're getting? Vintage is usually divided into categories, so let's briefly discuss high-end versus low-end clothing and everything in between. Dealers use this hierarchy to determine prices, so it's important for buyers to understand the various levels. For example, a numbered haute couture dress that's just 25 years old can cost many thousands of dollars, yet a lovely homemade frock from the 1930s may barely fetch $75. They are both vintage, but their differences are like apples and oranges. High-end versus low-end clothing in the vintage market follows the same conventions and structure as in modern garment making. I'll refer often to these levels, so here's a short list of the most common ones. Haute couture, the highest quality of vintage clothing. Haute couture was, and continues to be, made to order using the most exclusive fabrics and the finest dressmaking techniques. Couture, a shortened term for haute couture. It is sometimes misused to describe anything from a high-end designer. Ready-to-wear or prêt-à-porter, clothing that was bought off the rack, not custom-made. Better designer. High-quality, limited runs of important designer wear that was bought off the rack. Fabrics tend to be excellent, and craftsmanship is superb, sometimes on par with couture. Budget designer. Designer label clothing that is of lesser quality, mostly found after the 1960s. Then designer wear or couture. Fabrics and construction vary in quality. Better name. This term refers to a high-quality manufacturer or a very good but lesser-known designer. It also includes high-end department store labels, such as Bonwit Teller, Neiman Marcus, and Saks Fifth Avenue. The quality often rivals that of better designer wear. Budget and mid-range. Clothing that was manufactured for lower-priced markets of varying degrees. This category includes mail-order catalogs like Sears, as well as low- to mid-range department stores. Fabrics are less expensive, and construction is adequate, but not superior. Despite the diminished quality, designs can be very nice. Dressmaker. Made-to-order clothing created by professional dressmakers. The quality varies, but tends to be excellent. Designs are usually derived from popular styles of the day. Very little innovation, as a rule. Home sewn. Clothing made by non-professional home sewers. Quality varies from very poor to excellent. Tailor-made. Clothing made to order by a tailor as opposed to a dressmaker. Tailors tend to limit themselves to making and altering suits and outerwear for men and women. The quality can vary, but tends to be excellent. There is usually very little innovation in design, however. So, as you can gather, vintage is a bit more complicated than you might have first thought. But with this overview, you now have a good working definition of what vintage is. If I had to sum up my personal definition in one sentence, it would be this: fashions from the past that are worthy of resurrection. Determining what is worthy is, of course, open to debate and rather subjective. There are really no absolutes when it comes to vintage style. Now let's move on to identifying the varied categories and appreciating their many unique qualities. Chapter 2. On the Market. Why do you enjoy wearing clothing from another era? For some, it's purely a collector's passion. They want the perfect Madame Gray gown or Dior suit. Others are attracted to the nostalgia the clothes evoke, from post-war femininity to boho chic. A few have a specific goal. Costumers and fashion designers seek authentic pieces on which to base their modern designs. Buying vintage is a form of recycling, an eco-friendly indulgence. Many people shop for vintage because it offers value and a fun, easy way to escape today's disposable culture. So whether you're looking to save the earth or just some cash, vintage offers fabulous quality and a range of categories, from underwear to outerwear. Unique chic. Vintage makes a statement. One of the greatest complaints I hear from my customers is that modern clothing is so cookie cutter, and a trip to the local mall quickly reveals that mainstream designs are increasingly generic. The fashion industry has always been highly competitive, and creating for the mass market is not a new phenomenon. But with today's insatiable demand for cheap, plentiful goods, manufacturers have had to cut corners. The result is not only diminished quality, but a decline in style and innovation. For those who crave a wider palette from which to build a wardrobe, vintage is a fabulous resource. With all the variety and one-of-a-kind finds, vintage easily fulfills the desire for a signature style. Beautiful classics abound, from little black dresses to smartly tailored suits and timeless coats. You'll discover a wide array of staple separates, including pretty blouses, cozy sweaters, and smart skirts. Most women pair these pieces with contemporary basics to create a distinctive style. For those on a funkier fashion quest, vintage is a natural source for experimentation. I love watching the muse at work when imaginative customers cobble together unlikely combinations, such as psychedelic print tops over jeans or novelty wool blazers or sweaters with today's designer skirts. Celebrities sometimes even turn to vintage gowns for black tie events because only then can they be certain no one else will walk in wearing the same thing. Nearly every vintage shop will have a healthy section of event-worthy cocktail or dinner dresses. There's even a flourishing vintage bridal market. And let's not forget accessories. Pearl necklaces, rhinestone brooches, fur hats, spiky heels, straw handbags, and on. Don't be afraid to mix old and new, funky and traditional, to create a look that's as individual as you are. Quality and craftsmanship. Today's ready-to-wear market features scads of clothing made from not-so-great fabrics in varying qualities of cut and construction. Some modern labels are still well-made, with fine-quality fabrics, but they are usually very expensive. According to yesteryear's standards, yarns for knitwear should not pill, silk should not wrinkle when crushed, and linen should drape nicely and not feel stiff and wiry. Even some of the old synthetics, such as the Kiana nylons of the late 1960s and 70s, have beautiful qualities not seen today. Many of these old textiles are no longer available or are so prohibitively expensive that they can be found only in haute couture. It's amazing to think that much of the vintage you come across has been worn, washed, and stored for years, yet is still perfectly wearable. That's because most women were taught the basics about purchasing quality clothing, and as educated consumers, they demanded that manufacturers uphold certain standards if they wanted to stay in business. Today, there is no such education, and most modern consumers seem more interested in low price than high quality. Fortunately, vintage is the last holdout of truly fabulous fabrics you can actually afford. Unless you can actually afford couture. And if so, lucky you. As a vintage shopper, you're sure to encounter luxurious cashmeres that will not pill, cotton sateens that feel like silk, and the most beautiful pure woolens you have ever laid eyes on. You'll see luxurious silk satins and metallic brocades fit for royalty. Clothing makers used all kinds of wonderful laces and eyelets, and you may happen upon the real thing. Handmade lace that might have taken months or even years to create. Of course, not all older textiles are at such a high level, but even everyday vintage clothing tends to be made from a greater variety and higher quality of materials than those seen today. Vintage also affords fine examples of the dressmaker's art. In the past, Much clothing was designed with strategically placed fitting lines that conform nicely to the body's shape, and there are decent seam allowances that permit easy alterations. In fact, before the 1970s, it was common to find couture-level workmanship in better ready-to-wear clothing. Even budget-line clothing was made well by today's standards. Just as consumers were trained to spot good fabrics, they were equally aware of how to recognize proper fit. To save time and money, today's manufacturers often cut corners by reducing fitting lines. Have you ever noticed how the shoulders of your blazers never seem to fit right?
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.